Hey kiddies, it's Triple Feature Tuesday once again, and this week we're going to look at movies based on comics that did not have an ending when they were made. That's right, these are three movies that were based on, you know, relatively famous comics and or infamous comics. It was like medium, a lot of different ranges. But the thing of it was, they were made... They were stories that did have an ending in mind, and yet the films were made before the endings came out, you know, to capitalize on the cultural zeitgeist. Fun fact, none of these did. Most of these were considered, you know, flops or, you know, not anything to write home about. And considering how much money was put into one of them, we're never going to see a, you know, relatively independent movie of this caliber again. And I blame each and every one of you for it, but we'll get into that later. So we're going to go in order of increasing accuracy to the comic in terms of the ending. So our menu is going to include Uzumaki, Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, and Faust, Love of the Damned. So, Uzumaki, based on the manga by Junji Ito, is about a town in Japan called Kurozu-cho, which has become cursed with spirals. Now, what the hell does that mean, you ask, being a sane person? It means that spirals are kind of weaving their way into people's lives and driving them completely insane to the point that they end up killing themselves or other people in the manner of reminiscent of a spiral. Like, for instance, in this movie, we have a guy committing suicide by putting himself in a laundry washing machine and ending up all curly queued up. There's a woman who cannot deal with any spirals after her husband, you know, killed himself in a washing machine after becoming obsessed with spirals. So after cutting all her fingerprints off, because those have spirals, she finds out that the cochlea in your ear is essentially a spiral, so she ends up stabbing her own head. Another kid gets run over and gets, you know, scrunched up like a spiral. But then it gets even weirder and weirder, because you have this one girl whose curly hair gets completely out of control and sucks out the life of her. And other people just start turning into snails, you know, with the shells. So it's very important to stay away from Kurozu-cho if you've got a spiral on you. But I live in Baltimore, so I'm perfectly fine. The thing of it was a very popular comic in Japan at the time, because Junji Ito is kind of the first name in horror manga. Unfortunately, he wasn't done. I think two volumes of the book were out by the time they decided to make the movie, and so the movie doesn't have an ending. And it doesn't have the ending from the book. I mean, it has no ending. Everything just kind of stops, and it ends on a close-up of the main girl, Kiri, kind of describing off-screen that, yeah, we're all dead now. It's really sort of lame, and it kind of takes all the wind out of the sails, or people are going to remember how a movie ends more than they remember how a movie begins. And so while Uzumaki has, visually, it's just a stunning film, it blows it at the end because it has no payoff to it in, which is a shame because the payoff in the comic is really, really great because everything turns into one gigantic symbiotic spiral and it's horrifying. But unfortunately, not so much for this movie. And so it kind of lives on as an visually interesting also-ran in terms of J-horror of the early aughts. Next up, we have Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, Edgar Wright's adaptation of the Scott Pilgrim comics by Brian Lee O'Malley. And oh boy, all of you failed this movie. The movie did not fail you. That movie was amazing. I mean, the casting was perfect. Who would have thought? Like, I mean, it's just because Scott Pilgrim is so unassuming that it's perfect that Michael Cera is playing Scott because Michael Cera is unassuming, and yet he totally got the character. Everybody got their characters, and everybody was ridiculous, and everybody was over the top, and the action was great. The editing was amazing. The look of the film was just so poppy and bubblegummy. It was great, and the songs and the music, and everybody's playing their own instruments, and you didn't like it! What do you have to say for yourself? I'm waiting for an answer. We'll find. So, Scott Pilgrim was a six-volume, or is a six-volume series, and all six volumes were out by the time the movie came out, but only two volumes were out by the time Edgar Wright and company started working on it, so they kind of had their work cut out for them after volume two. And if you notice, everything is pretty damn faithful up until the end of volume two in the film, for those of you who haven't read it. Everything after Chris Evans, Lucas Lee fight is sort of made up. They were clearly adapting things as they were going along. If you pay attention to the film and see how things were set up, Scott was supposed to end up with Knives in the film. That's why it's Knives and Scott teaming up to take down Gideon at the end, and Ramona is just kind of standing off to the side and doing nothing. It was only after the sixth volume came out and, you know, the canonical ending of the comic is that Scott and Ramona end up going off to start anew, kind of, you know, get their craziness out of their friend's hair and maybe see if they can be a couple on their own. That Edgar Wright and company had to come up with their own ending and then work out and then try to figure out a way to combine their ending with the ending of the comic. I don't hold that against them so much as I hold Edgar. Knives and Scott? I mean, at no point, even before the end came out, did I put Knives and Scott together, because as Knives explains at the end, she's too cool for him. She has her life together. She's going to have an amazing, productive life, and Scott Pilgrim is just a complete mess of a human being. And that's why he works so well with Ramona, because she is equally a mess of a human being. So it's just like, what were you thinking? Even though in the movie she does end up with Ramona at the end, it feels more tacked on than something that comes out organically. So it's kind of, it's not as satisfying as either ending would have been if they had, you know, been planning it all the way through. Like, I almost sort of want to see what it would have looked like with Scott ending up with Knives, since that would have been where the movie had been heading the entire time. But instead of, you know, heading there for 90% of the film and then, or 95% of the film and then taking a sharp right turn at the very end. But either way, that does not get any of you off the hook. Scott Pilgrim was amazing and none of you liked it. And I hate you forever for not making it the biggest movie of all time. Finally, we have Brian Yuzna's adaptation of Faust, Love of the Damned, by David Quinn and Tim Virgil. The movie, I don't have a copy of any of it because I'm not a complete sleazeball. Faust is an erotic action horror comic. Basically, it's a sleazeball jamboree where you have what starts as sort of a parody of the late 80s, early 90s Image Comics-esque excess of like super duper hardcore ridiculous superheroes with blades and capes and a dark past and evil secrets, and quickly become something crazier and, you know, pornier. But I've never actually read it. I've seen little synopses of it and bits of the comic online, and it's exactly what the movie looks like, which is pretty good. Brian Yuzna, a Spanish filmmaker, famous for working with Jeffrey Combs a lot of times. He did the sequel Bride of Reanimator and Beyond Reanimator. He did Return of the Living Dead. He does a lot of movies in Spain, including this one. Faust, if nothing else, is a great example of how to make a European movie sort of look like America, because for most of the movie it works perfectly, except for any time they actually are forced to use a public location, like say a subway, because that's just not an American subway, nor American payphones. Mark Frost and his amazing eyeballs star as John Jaspers, an artist turned dark superhero. Yes, we get the joke. And he has sold his soul to M, which might be short for Mephistopheles, we're not really sure, played by the always wonderful, always sinister Andrew Devoff. Only I can do his voice, though. God, it makes so much money. That's about all I can really say for certain. The rest of the movie sort of plays according to superhero tropes while, you know, being ridiculous and over the top. You can see a lot of Spawn in this movie, especially in the costume, because, like, in the comic, the costume appears to be just a costume, whereas in this one, Faust sort of grows the whole thing out of him, and so for the most of the movie, he's running around functionally naked, and whenever he changes back from his costume, he is, in fact, naked, because, again, porny, very porny, this film, and not afraid of it. Brian Yuzna will show lots of boobs, lots of butts, not a lot of male frontal dudity, but probably not for lack of trying. And he is not afraid to go really gross and horror with any of it, like at the drop of a dime. Like, something can go from really sexy to really gross and then back to really sexy, I guess. This movie movie's probably going to make you uncomfortable if you watch it, but that's okay. So, this movie came out in 2000. The comic book ran for 15 issues. It started publishing in 1987 and just finished in 2012. They were on their own timetable. I mean, it's artists. You can't really judge when they come out. You should be happy that anything is coming out. So who are you to complain? But yeah, 15 issues over 25 years. They did not, the last issue had not come out, but as near as I can tell, writer and artist Quinnen Vigil had talked to Brian Yuzna and the scriptwriter about how the end goes, because the end in the movie is essentially the end in the comic, which, good on them, because, God, I can't imagine what would have happened if they were improvising things, because it's just, this movie's so ridiculous, but really fun to watch, like, if only for, again, Mark Frost's facial expressions throughout this whole movie are priceless. And also, Jeffrey Combs is in this movie. Jeffrey Combs is playing an action hero in this movie. It's so great. For the majority of the film, he is playing a super-duper lone wolf renegade cop. He's got a leather jacket and, like, really awesome hair and sideburns and everything. And then by the end of the movie, he turns into the Jeffrey Combs we all know and love, which is good because we get, what, something new and different from Jeff. And then the Jeff that we paid to see in the film, to be quite honest. It's no shortage of special effects and makeup and gore, and again, boobs, lots of boobs, but just a hell of a lot of fun. All these movies are fun on the triple feature, which is great. They may not be good movies, but they are all fun. Scott Pilgrim was a good movie, though, and again, you guys screwed that up all to hell. So these were three comic book movies that came out before the ends of the comics, and the filmmakers had to adapt accordingly. Uzumaki, Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, and Faust, Love of the Damned. And I'll see you guys next week with my birthday triple feature, so that'll be fun.